The Magic of Reality: How We Know What's Really True. Written by Richard Dawkins and read by Richard Dawkins
and Lalla Ward.
Chapter 1. What is reality? What is magic? Reality is everything that exists. That sounds straightforward, doesn't it? Actually, it isn't. There are various problems. What about dinosaurs, which once existed but exist no longer? What about stars, which are so far away that, by the time their light reaches us and we can see them, they may have fizzled out? We'll come to dinosaurs and stars in a moment. But in any case, how do we know things exist, even in the present? Well, our five senses, sight, smell, touch, hearing and taste, do a pretty good job of convincing us that many things are real. Rocks and camels, newly mown grass and freshly ground coffee, sandpaper and velvet, waterfalls and doorbells, sugar and salt. But are we only going to call something real if we can detect it directly with one of our five senses? What about a distant galaxy too far away to be seen with the naked eye? What about a bacterium too small to be seen without a powerful microscope? Must we say that these do not exist because we can't see them? No. Obviously, we can enhance our senses through the use of special instruments, telescopes for the galaxy, microscopes for bacteria. Because we understand telescopes and microscopes and how they work, we can use them to extend the reach of our senses, in this case the sense of sight, and what they enable us to see convinces us that galaxies and bacteria exist. How about radio waves? Do they exist? Our eyes can't detect them, nor can our ears, but again, special instruments, television sets for example, convert them into signals that we can see and hear. So although we can't see or hear radio waves, we know they are a part of reality. As with telescopes and microscopes, we understand how radios and televisions work. So they enable our senses to build a picture of what exists, the real world, reality. Radio telescopes and X-ray telescopes show us stars and galaxies through what seem like different eyes. Another way to expand our view of reality. Back to those dinosaurs. How do we know that they once roamed the Earth? We've never seen them or heard them or had to run away from them. Alas, we don't have a time machine to show them to us directly. But here we have a different kind of aid to our senses. We have fossils, and we can see them with the naked eye. Fossils don't run and jump, but because we understand how fossils are formed, they can tell us something of what happened millions of years ago. We understand how water, with minerals dissolved in it, seeps into corpses buried in layers of mud and rock. We understand how the minerals crystallize out of the water and replace the materials of the corpse, atom by atom, leaving some trace of the original animal's form imprinted on the stone. So, although we can't see dinosaurs directly with our senses, we can work out that they must have existed using indirect evidence that still ultimately reaches us through our senses. We see and touch the stony traces of ancient life. In a different sense, a telescope can work like a kind of time machine. What we see when we look at anything is actually light, and light takes time to travel. Even when you look at a friend's face, you're seeing them in the past, because the light from their face takes a tiny fraction of a second to travel to your eye. Sound travels much more slowly, which is why you see a firework burst in the sky noticeably earlier than you hear the bang. When you watch a man chopping down a tree in the distance, there's an odd delay in the sound of his axe hitting the tree.
Light travels so fast that we normally assume anything we see happens at the instant we see it. But stars are another matter. Even the sun is 8 light minutes away. If the sun blew up, this catastrophic event wouldn't become a part of our reality until 8 minutes later. And that would be the end of us. As for the next nearest star, Proxima Centauri, if you look at it in 2011, what you are seeing is happening in 2007. Galaxies are huge collections of stars. We are in one galaxy called the Milky Way. When you look at the Milky Way's next-door neighbour, the Andromeda Galaxy, your telescope is a time machine taking you back 2.5 million years. There's a cluster of 5 galaxies called Stefan's Quintet, which we see through the Hubble telescope, spectacularly colliding with each other. But we see them colliding 280 million years ago. If there are aliens in one of those colliding galaxies, with a telescope powerful enough to see us, what they are seeing on Earth at this very moment, here and now, is the early ancestors of the dinosaurs. Are there really aliens in outer space? We've never seen or heard them. Are they a part of reality? Nobody knows. But we do know what kind of things could one day tell us if they are. If ever we got near to an alien, our sense organs could tell us about it. Perhaps somebody will one day invent a telescope powerful enough to detect life on other planets from here. Or perhaps our radio telescopes will pick up messages that could only have come from an alien intelligence. For reality doesn't just consist of the things we already know about. It also includes things that exist, but that we don't know about yet, and won't know about until some future time, perhaps when we have built better instruments to assist our 5 senses. Atoms have always existed, but it was only rather recently that we became sure of their existence, and it's likely that our descendants will know about many more things that for now we do not. That is the wonder and the joy of science. It goes on and on, uncovering new things. This doesn't mean we should believe just anything that anybody might dream up. There are a million things we can imagine, but which are highly unlikely to be real. Fairies and hobgoblins, leprechauns and hippogriffs. We should always be open-minded, but the only good reason to believe that something exists is if there is real evidence that it does.
Models, testing our imagination. There is a less familiar way in which a scientist can work out what is real when our 5 senses cannot detect it directly. This is through the use of a model of what might be going on, which can then be tested. We imagine, you might say we guess, what might be there. That is called the model. We then work out, often by doing a mathematical calculation, what we ought to see or hear, etc., often with the help of measuring instruments, if the model were true. We then check whether that is what we actually do see. The model might literally be a replica made out of wood or plastic, or it might be a piece of mathematics on paper, or it might be a simulation in a computer. We look carefully at the model and predict what we ought to see or hear if the model were correct. Then we look to see whether the predictions are right or wrong. If they are right, this increases our confidence that the model really does represent reality. We then go on to devise further experiments, perhaps refining the model, to test the findings further and confirm them. If our predictions are wrong, we reject the model, or modify it and try again. Here's an example. Nowadays we know that genes, the units of heredity, are made of stuff called DNA. We know a great deal about DNA and how it works, but you can't see the details of what DNA looks like, even with a powerful microscope. Almost everything we know about DNA comes indirectly from dreaming up models and then testing them. Actually, long before anyone had even heard of DNA, scientists already knew lots about genes from testing the predictions of models. Back in the 19th century, an Austrian monk called Gregor Mendel did experiments in his monastery garden, breeding peas in large quantities. He counted the numbers of plants that had flowers of various colours, or that had peas that were wrinkly or smooth, as the generations went by. Mendel never saw or touched a gene. All he saw were peas and flowers, and he could use his eyes to count different types. He invented a model, which involved what we would now call genes, though Mendel didn't call them that, and he calculated that, if his model were correct, in a particular breeding experiment, there ought to be 3 times as many smooth peas as wrinkly ones. And that is what he found when he counted them. Leaving aside the details, the point is that Mendel's genes were an invention of his imagination. He couldn't see them with his eyes, not even with a microscope, but he could see smooth and wrinkled peas, and by counting them, he found indirect evidence that his model of heredity was a good representation of something in the real world. Later scientists used a modification of Mendel's method, working with other living things such as fruit flies instead of peas, to show that genes are strung out in a definite order along threads called chromosomes. We humans have 46 chromosomes, fruit flies have 8. It was even possible to work out, by testing models, the exact order in which genes were arranged along chromosomes. All this was done long before we knew that genes were made of DNA.
Nowadays, we know this, and we know exactly how DNA works, thanks to James Watson and Francis Crick, plus a lot of other scientists who came after them. Watson and Crick could not see DNA with their own eyes. Once again, they made their discoveries by imagining models and testing them. In their case, they literally built metal and cardboard models of what DNA might look like, and they calculated what certain measurements ought to be if those models were correct. The predictions of one model, the so-called double helix model, exactly fitted the measurements made by Rosalind Franklin and Maurice Wilkins using special instruments.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.